a popular drink and it still is. I get more props and stunts than Bruce Willis. A poet like Langston Hughes and can't lose when I cruise out on the expressway. Leaving the bodega, I say suave.
Chroma key is the process of using the color information in a video signal as a signal to replace that color with something else. You're all familiar with this. You've seen it on the TV while watching a weather reporter. They're standing in front of a green screen, but through the magic of computers, that green screen is replaced with dramatic footage of tropical storm whatever, or charts and graphs of what's going on in the weather over the next couple of days. It's cool technology that we use today, but it dates back a lot longer than I thought. It goes back over 100 years. Back then, people knew when they were making films on, you know, old school film stock that you could do double exposure. Namely, you could record a scene of maybe of a house at night, and then you could rewind the film, and then you could film someone in a ghost costume, and you could superimpose that picture on top of the house, and it would look like a ghostly appearance of a ghost in a house. That was kind of cool. They realized they could make it even better by using color. So what they could do is they could paint objects, say blue, put actors in blue uniform with blue makeup or whatever. And then when processing that film, they could project that film through a blue filter onto high contrast black and white film stock. And anything that was blue would appear black. Then they could physically overlay that mask, that black and white mask, on top of the other film and mask out regions and then do exposures or double exposures in really interesting ways, and thus Chroma Key was born. Now that was a very manual, complicated process involving lots of takes and chemicals and projection. These days it's all done digitally. It's a relatively simple algorithm to do in the digital domain. The most basic version is you scan through each pixel in the image. If the color of that pixel is in the range of colors that you want to replace, you replace it with something else. This can be done very quickly, very efficiently, well faster than real time, up to 4K resolution, whatever you want. You can go really smart with it. You can do complicated things whereby you take into account potential variations in the lighting of the green screen from different lights. You can deal with transparent and translucent objects and refraction and all of those things with more complicated digital algorithms, but computers do it really well. So of course, I decided to try and do some of that in the analog domain. Before we dive into how these mess of wires and cables enable you to do Chroma Key in the analog domain, it's probably worth having a quick refresher on how analog video signals work. For a deep dive, you can look at some other videos I've made on component versus composite video and some work on color theory as it pertains to video. But at a very high level, here we are looking at a standard sort of test image on our monitor. And video is transmitted one sort of scan line at a time. And here on the oscilloscope, we're looking at a scan line, a horizontal line, from sort of this portion of the signal here. Component video is sent over three channels, Y, PB, and PR, which I've got reflected here on these three channels on my oscilloscope. The Y channel is luminance, or effectively brightness. If you're used to thinking about video in sort of the RGB color space, this is primarily the green signal, but a bit of red and blue is mixed in there as well to get sort of the black and white effective brightness of the image. The PB channel is the B component from RGB subtracted by from the Y, or the luminance. And PR is the red channel minus the Y channel, giving you this signal here. And so as you look sort of left to right, you're looking left to right across the screen. This first little budup budup here, that is the technical name, that is actually a horizontal sync pulse. That tells the receiver that a new line is about to come. If you've looked at these sort of signals before with sort of standard definition video, NTSC or PAL, you're probably used to seeing sort of a little 700 millivolt negative spike just in that direction. Here we have a tri-level sync pulse. This is what's used in HD video signals. It gives you better sort of timing resolution. This is all operating at HD 1080p video. And pixels are flying by at sort of north of 100 megahertz. So we are no longer in SD land anymore. But to help orient yourself, these little pips you see here correspond to the vertical white lines of the grid line. And this middle section here is cycling through the colors in the test pattern here. So let's say we wanted to replace this magenta with something else. The way you do that in an analog circuit is you'd identify the voltages on the Y, PB, and PR that correspond to that magenta here. So this portion of the signal there, there, and there. And you'd replace it with something else. So you'd use some sort of analog comparator, some logic gate, and then a switch to switch out to something else. And that's exactly what this thing does. So if we turn this knob here, we have replaced magenta. We're replacing it with some sort of random sine waves coming out of my oscilloscope. It would be cool to replace it with another video signal so everything was sort of lined up. But of course, for that to work, you'd need the sync pulses to line up. You'd need sort of the two input channels. Here's the main input, and here's sort of the overlay input. They'd need to be what you'd call gen locked, which is where the sync pulses both horizontally and vertically line up. And I unfortunately do not yet have the way of generating HD analog video gen locked video, but I'm working on it. So here we are. We have three knobs here, or three banks of knobs. This is the upper and lower limit of selecting the Y channel. So this voltage here, PB and PR. To get a better sense of what's going on, I've produced these sort of color charts here, which are in, technically they're in the Y, PB, PR color space, but because they're coming out of a Mac running Keynote through the operating system, there's gamma correction and other stuff going on, so it doesn't quite map linearly. Let's sort of select everything. In each of these charts, Y, the Y axis represents Y luminance. So if I turn the upper limit down, you can see I'm moving up and down. If I go PB, you can see I'm selecting some PBs there, and upper and lower limit there. And if I change the PR range, I can select one small segment of colors there. Now, it'd be nice if these were all orthogonal linear lines, but of course that's not happening because I don't have full linearity in my digital video signal chain. But this thing works, and it works pretty well, and I'm pretty happy with that. So let's zoom into the circuit board itself, and I'll give you a tour of the components. The circuit here is actually pretty straightforward. You'll notice that most of the components on this board are not populated. I'll get to that in a second. But what we do have here is four different types of chips that do this entire effect. So we have the video signal coming in here. That's the main signal. Whatever we want to replace the signal with, the overlay, comes in here. And we have our knobs here. So the video signal comes in. It goes into an OPA 3692. This is a three-channel high-speed op-amp designed for video with a bandwidth of up to 280 megahertz. Then the signal goes into FSAV 430MX, which is a four-channel high-speed video switcher, which supports bandwidth of up to 1.1 gigahertz, and then goes out via another OPA 3692 op-amp out here. And so what does the actual chroma keying is these four chips here. So we have three Max 9012s. These are high-speed comparators, dual comparators. So there's two comparators per chip. One comparator for the lower limit, one comparator for the upper limit. For the Y, PB, and PR, those outputs go into a 74LV21, which is a dual quad AND gate. So we AND all of the outputs of the comparators, and when all of those are set to high, namely we're in the range that is selected by these knobs, we indicate to this video switcher to switch to the other input. And then, as I said, just goes out via another op amp. It's all pretty straightforward. And it works. What it really comes down to is good component selection. You cannot do this with audio grade op amps. You cannot do this with low speed comparators or low speed logic gates. I really wanted to get this to be sort of high precision, low artifacts. And I was able to do that by using some pretty simple chips, but chips that were dedicated to doing high speed video work. And that's how the circuit works. There is absolutely no good reason to do chroma key in the analog domain, at least not these days. You can do it on computers way better with way fewer artifacts, and there's no real good reason to do it in the analog domain, but I did it anyway. So I wanted to share with you a little bit of the story as to why I'm doing this, and it all started with this little guy here that you may remember from a video I did about a year ago, which is my analog color corrector. So this is applying sort of log and exponential transforms to a component video signal to allow you to adjust, you know, fine adjustments to color signals. And this thing worked well in Spice, and it worked well on the bench with sort of test signals, but it did not work great in video. And there were two reasons for that. One is when you're sort of working with logs and exponentials, you can drive voltages way higher or way lower than what's allowed according to the video standard, so that you can mess up your sync pulses, it can mess up your white level. And the other thing that happens is as you're sort of finding the sweet spot, the knees of these curves of these transistors, you can sort of offset the average voltage away from the sync pulse, and again, you'll be outside of the range of a good video signal, and you'll just end up with a blue screen on a computer if you're trying to view this output on a computer. So I wanted to solve two problems. I wanted to solve the clipping, and I wanted to solve the DC restoration. I'll get into what DC restoration is in a second. So I started off by building this little circuit here. This is a MAX9012, so the same comparator with two little upper and lower limits. And the idea was the signal would come in here. If it was outside of the range set by this, it would get clipped to the range set by these two knobs. And this guy sort of worked in theory, but it didn't work in practice. There was no buffering, no op-amps between the input signal and the output signal, so that when the input went outside of the range here, it would get clipped to that range and brought back into the range, and the comparator would see it was back into the range, so it would unclip it, then it would clip again, and it turned into a high-speed oscillator. But the fact that it was a high-speed oscillator was a good sign. It meant that this MAX9012 and these other chips were working at very high frequencies. But as a high-speed oscillator, it wasn't a great clipping device. So out the back to the drawing board, and I came up with this guy here. This guy now has some op amps in here. This is just one channel of clipping between these two ranges. But I realized as I was drawing out this circuit that the difference between sort of clipping to a particular range versus like chroma keying on that range was not that hard. So I put some additional chips in here and let you select between are you in clipping mode or chroma key mode. And I had another, so input here, an overlay input here, and the output coming out there. And if you're in the sort of chroma key mode, you could select between the color range you want, and you'd replace the output with the overlay. And it worked pretty well. But there were some sort of visual artifacts that were coming to this. There was stray capacitance. I didn't think a lot about signal integrity in the design of this board. And while it sort of worked, it looked okay. It looked great for uploading to YouTube, but if you zoomed in, you could see artifacts, and I wasn't super happy with that. So I thought, you know what, I'm going to design this properly. And that's how I ended up with the design of basically the board that you see right now. But this is not the board that you actually saw me demoing. This is sort of the fully populated board, and I gave up on this one. And the reason why I gave up on this one is that I was trying to do too much. I was trying to do the DC restoration in here as well. And the way that I was doing DC restoration is I had an LM1881, which is a sync separator, which allowed me to get sort of a digital pulse whenever that sync blip happened. Then put that into a PIC chip, which then calculated the timing between the sync pulse and where sort of the back porch would be, which would be my known 0 volt level. Then once that would detect that, it would reset a capacitor to hold that new 0 volt level, and that would then feed into the op amp and do all the other things as per the other board. And it didn't work. When I was building this, I hadn't tested or hadn't even simulated the DC restoration, but I built all those components out on this board, and it all worked fine. But as soon as I put the op amp on here, it all sort of went to hell. As soon as I sort of shared the circuit diagram with some folks on Reddit, they sort of slapped me on the forehead, because op amps aren't ideal. There's a little bit of input bias current that's coming in or coming out of the inputs, and that drives the capacitor, whatever. It didn't work. But what did work about this after I removed all of the DC restoration stuff is what you saw in the video. And what I got out of that was really high quality. As you could see, there was no difference between the circuit being passed straight through, like not going through my board at all, and the output versus going through. Like, there were no noticeable artifacts. I'm sure if I went in and sort of did a pixel by pixel comparison, you'd see something. But I ran a spectrum analyzer over that circuit. I'm well north of 200 megahertz of 3 dB bandwidth. So like, I'm great for 1080p 60 hertz or 60 frame rate, which is fantastic. And it works. It does the chroma keying thing. My next thing is going to be to fix this DC restoration thing. Then I could enable circuits like this to work with a little bit more stability. So there's no real good reason for doing chroma key in the analog domain. Maybe there are some interesting cool artifacts that you could get by doing it in the analog domain, but that's a story for another day. Anyway, thanks for watching.